a Teacher Health and Wellness Act. And you're going to hear from our panelists today about why this is such an important bill for your members to pay attention to. Signing on to the bill, we have bipartisan support. Of course, Congressman Ryan, who is the primary sponsor, Susan Davis is co-sponsoring, and Elise Stefanik has also signed on as a sponsor. So we're really excited about that and hope to see a lot of support. So that's what you're going to hear about today in this briefing. Why a focus on teacher health and wellness? Why is that so important right now? I'm just going to hand this off. Presenting as our moderator today is Jean Wilhoit, who is with the Aspen Institute's National Commission on Social, Emotional, and Academic Development. He is a commissioner there. He's also the CEO for the Center for Innovation in Education at the University of Kentucky. And Jean served as executive director of the Council of Chief State School Officers. Many of you are familiar with that organization, from 2006 to 2013. And there he spearheaded state's collective action to adapt the Common Core standards, to adopt the Common Core standards. I know. Okay, let's not go there. Marshaled a restructuring of teacher and leader supports, including a consensus on preparation reform, and stimulated state action to improve data systems, and founded the Multi-State Innovation Lab Network. So Jean has been a longtime leader in education in his state and beyond, and we're really excited to have him moderating the panel today. And Jean will be introducing the remaining speaker. So thank you again all for being here.
Good morning. Among the impactful changes that have occurred in public education over the most recent years is this redefinition of what we expect for our children. In two ways, there is a major shift underway in the states and at the local level. First, we are beginning to redefine what's important for student learning. The knowledge, of course, the content that students should know to be successful, but also the skills and dispositions that these students must possess. So we're hearing this message from multiple audiences. It's a loud cry coming from practitioners, parents, business folks, and others across the country. The second big shift is that we're expecting every child to reach these outcomes. Before, it was okay, not moral, but okay, that some students didn't reach these lofty goals. That's changed. So in order for our teachers to be successful, they need several things. They need to know that this society appreciates them for who they are, that this chosen profession is a lofty one that needs a lot of positive signals, not negative ones, from society. Our teachers need to know that they're going to be provided the highest quality of professional training when they enter the classroom, and that throughout their career, they have the kinds of supports to advance their professional practice. They need to know that they're compensated commensurate with the role they're playing in this society. They need to know that our assessment and accountability systems, we all believe in accountability, but those systems need to be fair, need to be developmental, not punished. And almost 50% of them are being diagnosed with excessive daytime fatigue and poor sleep quality. It's a real issue in large numbers. Clearly, this bill is sorely needed, and it's wonderful to see many organizations who signed on to support the bill. So this briefing is intended to explore the issue and to provide some highlights of actions that might be undertaken around teacher health and wellness. And to do so, we have an outstanding panel. Patricia Jennings, Joshua Brown, and Corey Smith. I'll say a bit more about each of them as they come forward. We will hear from each member of the panel, and then I'll make some summary comments, and then we'll open this up for comments and questions from everyone in the room. Our first presenter is Dr. Jennings. She's an associate professor in the Curry School at the University of Virginia. She's an internationally recognized leader in the fields of social and emotional learning and mindfulness in education, with a specific emphasis on teacher stress and how it impacts the social and emotional context of the classroom. Dr. Jennings led a team that developed CARE for teachers, mindfulness-based professional development program shown to significantly improve professional development opportunities for teachers in terms of supportiveness, in terms of sensitivity to the environment, in terms of their own well-being, and in terms of classroom productivity. She is leading the development of a compassionate school project curriculum, which is an integrated health and education program designed to align with state and national health and phys ed standards. She's co-principal investigator in my home state in Louisville to evaluate our curriculum's efficacy. Earlier in her career, she has been a Montessori teacher, a school director, and a teacher educator. She is the author of Mindfulness for Teachers, Simple Skills for Peace and Productivity in the Classroom. Tish, welcome to the podium.
Thank you very much. It's really great to be here, and I appreciate you coming to hear what we have to tell you about this bill and what the needs the teachers have. Before I begin, I'm curious, how many of you have ever been a teacher at some point in your career? Yeah, I had a feeling there were a lot of you here. So I think what I'm going to tell you, you probably know something about yourself from your own personal experience. So I started practicing mindfulness before I became a teacher. And I realized at some point that it was definitely helping me manage the stress of teaching. But when I became a teacher educator, I didn't quite know how to help my students. And I spent some time as a supervisor of student teachers, and I observed these teachers, and I kept seeing how stress was interfering with their performance. And because I was curious about why this was happening and how I might help them, I went back and got my doctorate in human development with a focus on stress and coping. And I've been bringing that information back into the classroom. So one of the things I've realized over this time is that the classroom is a very stressful context. Teachers often feel like this. And when you think about it through the lens of health psychology and stress and coping, it all makes sense. You put a bunch of people in a room, a bunch of little people in a room with one adult, and you tell them all that they can't leave, because the teacher can't walk out of the classroom, right? The kids can't leave either. And is the awareness that emerges through paying attention on purpose in the present moment, non-judgmentally, to the unfolding of experience moment to moment. But in the research literature, we've been focusing primarily on how we direct our attention to this present moment, and also cultivating this orientation towards our experience that is curious and open and accepting. So that in those moments, when things get challenging in the classroom, not only can we notice what's going on inside of us, our own reactivity, we can manage that reactivity, we can see what's really happening instead of allowing our biases to interfere with our perception, and then we can respond in a thoughtful way rather than reacting unconsciously. So there's a lot of different mindful awareness practices that you've probably heard of. You can practice it formally or informally. You can do focused attention or an open awareness practice. And there are different kinds of practices that help engage your sense of caring and compassion for others. You can also bring it into movement like yoga, walking, and other martial arts, and paying attention to your body. So how can mindfulness help teachers? Well, there's a large body, a growing body of literature that is pointing to support for this model, that mindful awareness practices, what we call them MAPS, support teachers' ability to manage their emotions in an adaptive way. We know from a lot of research that the tendency among teachers is to suppress emotional experience. Because you're trying to teach, you're trying to do what you're doing, so you start feeling a certain feeling and you suppress it, which is really bad for your health, your cardiovascular system, and a lot of other parts of the autonomic nervous system. So what we're helping them to do is find other ways to manage this emotional reactivity other than suppression. And also support their ability to cope. Then we see that it's reducing burnout and psychological distress in several studies, and increased energy and self-regulatory resources so that they're more resilient. Finally, it allows them to be more supportive to their students, and it's starting to show impacts on students as well. So today, I'm going to talk about the Cultivating Awareness and Resilience in Education, or the CARE for Teachers program that he was talking about. This is a very intensive professional development program. We made it intensive primarily because we weren't sure what the teachers would need in order to really affect their change in behavior. We wanted not only to help reduce their stress, but see that they actually became better teachers, that they were able to function better in the classroom and provide a more supportive classroom context. We also were hoping to have impacts on students. So in order to do that, we also felt we needed to have a pretty strong program in order to have those effects. We conducted the study in New York City in the Bronx and Upper Manhattan in schools that are high poverty schools. We did this also because we assumed that kids who were in most need would be most benefited by a teacher who was showing greater skillfulness in these social emotional competencies. So you can see the model. It was spread out over the period of the fall, and then we did a booster session in the spring. And in between these sessions, we talked to the teachers on the phone to provide support for applying what they were learning to not only their own self-care practice, but also how they were interacting with their students. So what is CARE? CARE is a combination of emotion skills and self-care concepts and mindfulness-based practices. In the emotional awareness part of the program, they learn a lot about emotions because the intention is to normalize the emotional experience. As teachers, we often feel guilty when we start having strong emotions, and we're trying to help them understand that it's normal and natural to have these emotions in the classroom. We just need to find some skillful ways to work with them. An example of this is when I talk to teachers about the kinds of anger that we feel in the classroom, I never use the word anger, because among teachers, that's not socially acceptable. So we talk about frustration, and we talk about annoyance, because it's more socially acceptable. Because as teachers, we don't want to be seen as angry people. So we normalize this emotional experience. We talk to them about how emotion impacts teaching and learning, and also we engage them in activities that help develop this emotional awareness. And this is a bodily felt sensation of emotion. Because those of you who've been teachers, you know when you're teaching, your attention is so outwardly directed all the time that often you don't check in to see how you're feeling, and then all of a sudden you find yourself really upset without realizing how did that happen? So tuning into the body and sensing the body before that happens gives teachers a chance to calm down and manage their emotions before it gets very strongly reactive. We do a whole variety of different kinds of mindfulness practices with the intention of giving them a variety to choose from in their own practice so they can find a self-care plan that works best for them. And we also do a variety of activities to help them generate care and compassion, because most people go into teaching with a very strong sense of altruism for caring for their students, but over time, with the erosion caused by stress, sometimes this caring, the experience of caring erodes. So we're trying to help boost that for our students, our teachers. And then we do a lot of different activities to apply these skills to teaching using healthy emotion regulation. Also, classrooms of teachers trained in CARE were independently observed to be higher on emotional supportiveness. The climate in the classrooms was more positive, and the teachers showed greater sensitivity to their students. And also student productivity compared to the control group. This is particularly important because
these were researchers who came into the classroom. They didn't know, they were blind to the condition of the teacher. They were observing the interactions in the classroom and coding them using a standardized measure of the classroom called the CLASS that was developed by our dean, Bob Pianta. And we showed this objective measure that those classrooms were better and better for learning, more supportive for learning. And we just published this paper, which is down referenced at the bottom of this slide. Now the other thing that's exciting about this research, we haven't published this yet, but the teachers that were trained in here continued to show benefits in psychological distress, mindfulness, and adaptive emotion regulation. And I'm going to show you some slides that give you a graphic example of the care. This is psychological distress. 0 is the fall of the first year, 1 is the spring of the first year, and 2 is the fall of the second year. And you can see over that course of a year, the care teachers continue to decline in distress, whereas the control group stayed fairly level. In mindfulness, we saw a continued increase in the care teachers over that same time period. And also emotion regulation continued to go up over the course of that time. So it's exciting to see that these approaches to supporting teachers can have impacts on the teachers themselves over a long period of time, a year, and at the same time impacts on their classroom. Our next work that he was alluding to is this understanding of how can we create a whole school approach to addressing stress, not just with the teachers, but also helping the students develop these skills. And in Louisville, Kentucky, this Compassionate Schools Project is a partnership between the University of Virginia, Jefferson County Public Schools, and Louisville, Kentucky. And we are in the midst of a very large randomized controlled trial. What we've done is we've reinvented the understanding of health and PE education to include social-emotional learning, mindfulness, postures and poses from yoga, and also healthy eating skills. And we're working on that right now. And you can learn more if you Google Compassionate Schools Project. It comes right up. One important point I just want to make is that the research that we've been conducting on the CARE project was funded by the Institute for Educational Sciences here in the federal government. We've had 2 federal grants to study this, and we've been very grateful that the IAS has been providing this support. I think this particular bill is really important because the funding is through NIH rather than IAS. IAS is primarily focused on student outcomes, and so all the research we've conducted had to have some student impact part of the study. And I think it's important to study teacher stress on its own, and so in that sense, I think it fits really well in the NIH. And I'm looking forward to your support moving forward. Thank you very much.
Next presenter is Dr. Joshua Brown. He's Associate Professor of Applied Developmental Psychology, Department of Psychology at Fordham University. His research focuses on development and evaluation of investment interventions within schools, teachers, and classroom settings that are designed to promote social, emotional, and academic development. He is engaged in several research projects, two of which I will mention. One is a study, randomized a trial of mindfulness-based professional development program with over 200 K-5 teachers in 36 New York City public
elementary. That's the same one I just talked about. Yeah.
Yeah. And the second one is this randomized study of around a program called the 4 R's program, reading, writing, respect, and resolution. Dr. Brown has served on the IOM Consensus Study Committee on the Science of Children, Birth to 8, and he recently co-authored a policy brief on teacher stress and health for the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, and is a recipient of the W.T. Grant Foundation Scholars Award. Josh,
here you go. Thank you, Gene. Good morning. Thank you for coming. Pleased to talk to you a little bit about the work I've been doing in support of teacher health and wellness. act. And to get started, actually, I think many of you have already the brief that was published and co-authored by myself and my colleague Mark Greenberg, from which much of the language that is in the proposed act has been drawn. And so I thought I would start out with just a brief video that might help summarize some of what's in that brief. And now I'm just trying to figure out how to make it work. So this is what I want to talk a little bit about today's interventions that I've worked on. Dr. Jennings has already presented a little bit about the CARE for Teachers Professional Development Program, but also another program, and all of them have as the goal not only supporting teachers' social-emotional competence development, but promoting children's social-emotional learning. We know these two things are tied closely together. So, in the absence of the video, let me try to kind of summarize a couple of key things. So we know a lot already about teacher stress and health. My colleague Jean here already mentioned in a national survey, we found that 46% of teachers reported high daily stress during the school year. And this is among the highest levels reported among all occupational groups. We know that chronic teacher work stress and exhaustion is associated with actually measured biological indicators of overall stress, which called allostatic load, as well as daily stress indicators as measured through the stress hormone, which is cortisol. Okay? Jean also mentioned that in a study of high school teachers, we found that 46% of those teachers were diagnosed with excessive daytime sleepiness, and 51%, over half, with poor sleep quality. These are critical. You know what it's like to show up at work without enough sleep. You're not firing on all pistons. And we have other evidence that this stress compromises teachers' health, physical health, and their quality of life. So this stress, and this is really, Tish started talking about this, this stress is linked to poor student outcomes. And we have a lot of evidence of this in the research literature, particularly among elementary school teachers. So we find that teachers who self-report higher levels of daily burnout, also have students who have elevated morning wakening levels of cortisol, the stress hormone. So teachers who report being burned out also have students who are experiencing biological measures of stress, which we've seen that. Teachers who report higher depressive symptoms have students who score lower on math tests. And we think that's in part because of poorer classroom interactions, the very thing that Tish had talked about that we showed an effect on in the CARE study. And we see that this effect is particularly bad for students who are at early academic risk. So students who start the year with lower math scores are particularly impacted by teachers who come in with higher levels of risk. Similarly, higher teacher burnout early in the school year is linked to greater classroom behavior problems, which makes sense. It's sort of like the reactivity dynamic that Tish was talking about, and that teachers who report higher burnout together with classroom behavior problems are linked to poor social and academic adjustment for students later in the year. And then lastly, teachers who report feeling emotionally exhausted in their work have classrooms with lower levels of reading achievement and lower student perceptions of teacher support. So they feel less supported by their teachers when the teachers themselves are saying, I'm exhausted, I have a hard time getting up, I'm exhausted facing the work I have to do today. So Tish presented this slide. This is here as a reminder. I want to tell you a little bit more about some of the findings we have from this randomized controlled study we did of the CARE for Teachers Professional Development mindfulness-oriented intervention. Our sample included 36 New York City public schools. As Tish said, they were from high poverty neighborhoods in Bronx, in Manhattan, in New York City. We engaged 224 teachers. You can see that the teacher sample is fairly diverse in terms of race, ethnicity. We have about 5,200 students in our sample. These are predominantly students of Hispanic or African American background. Just under 90% are receiving reduced price or free lunch. So this is a pretty disadvantaged set of schools and students. So As Tish said, I want to just show you our kind of exciting finding, which is that an intervention in mindfulness that Tish described has produced outcomes for students. This was not something teachers were told to deliver to students like a curriculum. This was teachers coming to another location outside of their school, receiving the set of mindfulness practices that Tish described. Those students who had those teachers who received the care training showed greater increases in academic engagement across the school year compared to their counterparts who had teachers that were not in the care training group. Now, this slide is showing you, as it's described in the title, that students who start out the year with lower social skills, so these are students at risk at the beginning of the school year, those students who start out with low social skills and have teachers who received the care training show greater gains in their reading competence compared to their counterparts, low social skills students of teachers in the control group. Okay, so what does this mean? This means that care training appears to differentially benefit students who start out the year at greater social, at greater risk because of low social skills, right? So when you train teachers in care, what this finding is showing is it might have particularly powerful benefits for kids who start out at behavioral risk at the beginning of the year, and that its benefits are showing up in an academic domain, reading competence, which is kind of interesting. And this is not an uncommon finding in the research literature on other social-emotional learning programs, that these programs might have a particularly powerful benefit for students at risk. So supporting teachers in social-emotional learning practices can benefit students at risk. Similarly, this appears to be that students of care teachers who themselves started the year low in mindfulness abilities also showed greater gains in reading competence compared to students of teachers who were low in mindfulness in our control group. So again, providing mindfulness practices to teachers who themselves might be at risk in certain ways, and here it's measured as low mindfulness, might also produce greater gains for students. So we have this sort of set of findings that suggest that supporting teachers through these mindfulness practices, as talked about by Tish, might benefit students at risk and teachers at risk. How does this happen? How are these effects on students happening? I'm not going to go into the details of these findings, but we now have good evidence. And Tish talked about how the CARE program impacted mindfulness for teachers and impacted their emotion regulation, their ability to regulate their emotions. We now see evidence that those changes in teacher mindfulness and teacher emotion regulation are what is affecting changes for students. So we see this kind of progression of effects. Right? Improving teacher mindfulness leads to higher student engagement, higher student academic motivation, and higher student social skills. And improvements in teacher emotion regulation produce improvements in student social skills at the end of the year. And we've tested this in what we call a causal chain. So we're pretty confident that it's the changes in the teachers that are, in part, what's producing positive changes both social, emotional, and academic outcomes for students. Skip that. So let me turn quickly to a different type of social, emotional learning intervention, and I call this a curriculum-based social, emotional learning intervention. And Jean mentioned that I am conducting the study of the Reading, Writing, Respect, and Resolution program, which is called 4Rs, and I'm going to briefly tell you about the findings from a large randomized trial that was done on just 4Rs, 5 minutes left, together with a coaching, and then a subsequent study of the coaching program. So in the original study of the 4Rs program, what is 4Rs? 4Rs has a curriculum, and what's unique about this curriculum is that it integrates the teaching of social-emotional skills inside of a literacy curriculum. So teachers use high-quality children's literature to teach about social skills. So it meets both literacy needs and social emotional needs. And the second component is training and in-person coaching of teachers. So coaches come into the school and work in person with teachers throughout the school year, roughly 12 to 15 times throughout the school year. It's a very time and face-to-face intensive model of coaching. We found, and I'm not going to go through all this, we found a lot of positive benefits based on what children told us about themselves, about how they solve problems, about how they feel. We saw changes in depressive symptoms. We saw changes in how they interact in social situations and in how teachers reported about their students. We saw improvements in aggressive behavior, ADHD symptoms, and social competence. And we saw, again, like the finding I talked about before, particularly good impacts for students who were at highest behavioral risk in terms of their math achievement and how teachers rated their academic skills. So again, we have that same pattern of findings. Students at higher risk seem maybe even more benefited by the receipt of this intervention. So those are the findings from one study. We then added the coaching model, which in short, it's a very intensive way of working with teachers, which gives them the opportunity to review videotapes of their teaching with a coach, with a master coach, looking at strategic interactions that take place during the delivery of the curriculum. Teachers are also provided with online exemplars of really high quality teaching interactions, and they have a series of cycles throughout the school year. Eight cycles throughout the school year of this coaching model and delivering the 4 hours curriculum. We did a pilot study with 6 schools and 35 classrooms and a little over 500 students, a diverse sample of teachers and students, like with the CARE study. And the intervention was 5 days of training and these 8 video-based coaching cycles. And what we did was we compared the 4 hours program with this intensive video-based coaching model to the original in-person only model. We wanted to see if those strong benefits that we saw from the original study were even better when teachers are supported with a very structured set of coaching procedures. And sure enough, we did. We saw improved results for 5 of the 10 student outcomes that we looked at. These are a combination of social-emotional outcomes, like how children perceive social interactions, whether they perceive them hostily or benignly, how they make choices in conflicted social interactions. We call that aggressive interpersonal negotiation strategies, social competence, academic skills, and attendance as measured by the New York City Department of Education. So teachers who receive this high-quality integrated coaching model compared to our original in-person model only had students who came to school more. What are some implications of this work? You can take social-emotional learning does not stand alone. It can be integrated with traditional academic content. And when you do that, we see improved academic outcomes in terms of academic skills and attendance. And we see that this standardized video-based coaching model to support teachers' implementation of a social-emotional learning program can improve students' academic and social-emotional outcomes. I want to just let you know that there is a large trial of which I am the PI that's happening right now in New York City. It's a school randomized trial. We're studying 60 New York City public elementary schools. We're focused on 350 teachers in grades 3 and 4 and about 8,000 students to take this video-based model and put it to a much broader test. And both the studies I've talked about, the CARE study and the 4Rs plus MTP studies, have been funded by IAS, which has been very exciting because this is showing national interest in really supporting teachers as best as we know how. Thank you.
Our last presenter is from a direct practitioner's point of view, not a researcher, so we're combining the expertise here. But Corey Sanchez-Smith is the SEL, Social Emotional Learning Coordinator in Atlantic Public Schools. She's a proud native of Berkeley, California. She started the teaching career in a small Title I school in California after receiving her degree from Spelman. She later achieved a master's in community counseling at the University of Oklahoma. Since starting her career, Corey has taught in urban districts, a charter school, and a private school in both Title I and non-Title I settings across 3 states. After a time in the classroom, Corey moved into instructional support administration, where she has led professional learning sessions in curriculum and design, and developed an in-depth knowledge of school community building, of shared decision-making, of program implementation, and teacher development and evaluation. Corey is also a Gallup certified strength coach and a trainer of restorative practices. She uses all of this background and diverse expertise as she works with students and adults in her home district of Atlanta. Corey, the floor.
Thank you. Hello.
Hello.
So I'm last. I've got to, you know, bring the energy, right? Keep you off your cell phones, hopefully. As was shared, my name is Corey Sanchez-Smith, and I am the SEL coordinator in Atlanta. Like he said, I started in a Title I school at the end of a dead-end street where no one really traveled. And when Tish first showed me that cartoon of the classroom, I was thinking, is that my classroom? Is that me? Because that's how I felt, right? I started teaching in 1998, and I know that a whole bunch of us who were starting the journey felt that way then, and it's still very true for how people feel now about just trying to hold on, that feeling of being completely overwhelmed. So I'm really excited to be here to talk about ways to address that feeling and move forward, right? And make things a little bit better. So 2 years ago, my district started the SEL initiative, and they had a job posting for SEL coordinator, and I read the description. I'm like, well, that sounds awesome, but I have no idea what SEL is. Like, what is that? Because it wasn't a word or an acronym we were using. So I'm really skilled. At using Google. And I did that and found this definition here, right? So social emotional learning is the process through which children and adults, that's in there, acquire and effectively apply the knowledge, attitudes, and skills necessary to understand and manage emotions, set and achieve positive goals, feel and show empathy for others, establish and maintain positive relationships, and make responsible decisions. Well, I mean, I just thought that was the best thing in the whole world. Like, who doesn't want to do that? Right? So, of course, I applied for this job because that is why most of us went into education, right? To develop whole, happy people that enter the world and just make us all better. So, I have a small team that I work with, and they're awesome, and we got really excited, and we started looking at the work. Focused on what Castle tells us about these 5 core competencies, that became our what, right? What are we doing? What are we grounded in? What are we focused on? What do we align our resources to? So we have this, one of our trainings called SEL in the Classroom, which now that I say it out loud is a really boring title for training, but I encourage people to come. But what we do in that training is we go through each of the competencies and we say, if you have a classroom that's reflective of SEL, where is the space or what is the arrangement for self-awareness where a student can develop that skill? And what do you have in terms of furniture alignment that supports relationship skills? And if you were to travel your classroom, where would I see social awareness and perspective taking and empathy? So we really do ground our work in these 5 core competencies. From Castle, we also learned about the where, right? So where does SEL take place? It sounds pretty simple. So we have explicit instruction. We also integrate it with our academic content and our pedagogy. We model for students constantly throughout the day. And I have to stop when I talk to teachers and I say, okay, now when you got mad because someone jammed the copier, right? And you're rolling your eyes in the hallway because you cannot make a single copy, like the students are seeing that, right? That's part of our modeling. So when we model throughout the day, part of that is modeling how to get through a stressful situation because that's what they learn from us. And so we model, we integrate, we also take advantage of teachable moments, right? So I was queen of taking over the playground. If you got on the playground, I was going to separate and, you know, judge and jury right here. Not so smart. Because what I failed to do was develop the skills within the students to handle the situation themselves. And that's what SEL says. It says we take ourselves out and we facilitate a process where people develop the skills to make their best decisions for themselves.
So my judge and jury of the playground was time efficient, but it really didn't develop people that we want as they progress into the world. So we started this work, we were in schools, we were training, we were making it happen. We were really excited, and about 5 seconds later, we realized this wasn't about the kids. I don't think it ever was. It's really about the teachers. That to expect someone to develop community and nurturing environments and build cohesion in the classroom, they have to have that. You cannot give what you do not have. So do our teachers work in environments that are collaborative and supportive and nurturing and emotionally safe? Because if that is not given to them, how can we expect that to be given to their students? So we really had to back up and say, this work is about supporting the big people so the knowledge can get to the little people, right? So we have this, this awareness of our new strategy now, right, of developing teachers, and we went back to some research. What do we know? So we know that the emotional skills of teachers influence student conduct, engagement, attachment to school, and academic performance. That's in line with what you heard from the other two presenters, and that makes complete and total sense. If I'm a teacher excited about what I'm doing, and I am fully into who is in front of me, and I want to make you excited about what you're doing, I, as a student, am going to be engaged. And because I'm engaged, I'm going to perform academically. It makes complete and total sense. We also know that teachers that are skilled at regulating their own emotion report less burnout, which was also presented earlier. So I have, like was mentioned, which kind of sounds funny to say, I've taught in 3 different states. Promise it was for good reasons, but I've taught 3 different states. And in every environment in which I've worked, as an educator, those of you who get it, it's always something, right? It's always something. It's always something new. It's always something stressful. And a lot of times, it's always something last minute. So that's not going to go away. And I would imagine it's true for other professions as well. So my ability to take that something and say, and breathe through it, say, okay, I can do this, right? Or my inability to manage that and have it overwhelm me all impacts students. So what else do we know? We also know that adults who have the ability to recognize, label, and express their own emotions are likely to demonstrate patience and empathy for the people in the classroom. But one thing we know about people, not just teachers, is that only about 36% of people tested can identify their emotion as they're having them. Identify their emotion that they're having as they're having it. Dr. Jennings talked about the different parts of the brain and that we feel things before we know what it is. And so our work with SELs, how do we connect this feeling, that turning in my stomach, that tightening on my shoulders, right? That heat that I start to feel with an emotion, because when I know the word for it, I can advocate for myself. So that's work that we have to do with big people so that the little ones can do it too. I stop on that because these are facts that we share with teachers, and I connect with my own experience. I remember not too long ago, and some of you, this is true for you, have you ever driven to work and you have everything going on in your brain, every meeting, every email, whether or not you're gonna eat lunch that day, all that's going through your brain, and you look up and you realize, I don't know how I got on this street, right? Like, when did I actually turn? So I'm having that moment, and then my second thought was, I don't know if I dropped off my son. To the point where I have to turn around and look in the car seat to make sure he's not there. And so first I'm relieved, and then I'm confused. I'm telling you, then it becomes, I'm sad, because for the span of time that I unbuckled him from his seat and took him into the classroom and kissed him goodbye and left, he didn't have me. I wasn't there. I was not present. And I share that story because it is my lack of mindfulness that I'm running on constantly, that I can do my work, but I'm not in my work. And I'm not the only one, because when I share that story, overwhelmingly, a teacher or two, or an administrator in the audience, they get a little teary-eyed, and they come up to me afterwards and go, I did that too. And I do that too. And so we have this stress and this lack of connection, and we have this emotional dissonance that we're dealing with as we enter into the workforce, and it happens every day. So what do we do about it, right? The good news is there's a lot of things that we can do about it. And the mindfulness I'm really excited about, because, you know, Oprah told me about 5 years ago to buy a gratitude journal, and I bought it. But I have not started using it yet. But I'm going to work on it because I do need to be grateful, and I need to be mindful, and I need to be reflective, and I need to be all these things that we want our students to be. And so there are practices that big people, that us adults can take into place to help get through life so we can be there for the people in front of us. I will say that part of our SEL initiative, we work on community gatherings, which is what it sounds like. The community comes together in the morning. We sit in a circle, literally, and we connect with each other, which can sound kind of, oh, that's sweet, right? Like, oh, that's great. But actually, it's pretty powerful because we have students looking across from each other and realizing they have more in common than they have different. And we have a chance to bring what's going on in our home, in our life, to the classroom. And over and over and over again, I have teachers that come and tell me, I didn't know this much about my kids before. And so what that I didn't know about my kids before turns into is, I know how to help them. I know what they're dealing with. I know how to get them excited because they told me what they're doing on weekends. And I know what's novel and what's, you know, what they're into, which helps my instruction. So I know my students more. I'm gonna go back to my experience as a beginning teacher. I have a story, we all have stories as children, but I did not have the story that my students had. I was trying to support a community of children that had needs that I could not help with, to the point where it felt debilitating. That for me, teacher stress was not the curriculum because I was taught about math, right? For me, teacher stress was I knew I had people in front of me and I was not doing what they needed me to do. I did not know how to help them. And so I leaned on the counselor at my school over and over again, the social worker, and I actually went to get a degree in counseling, not because I ever want to be a counselor. I love counselors, but that's not my passion. I needed my counseling degree to be a better teacher. I needed more skills to be able to do my job. Because I can go on and on about this novel, but part of that is going to go right over your head if you're dealing with some other really deep stuff going on. So I wish, as a development teacher, I had SEL as part of my learning and development. I wish I had part of my school focus, because not only are we supporting teachers in developing their practice, but we're giving them tools to make a difference when they know that it's there. Right? They know that I need something more. That was stressful for me, and that's stressful for people today. But I don't want to focus only on teachers because they are lovely and wonderful, and I am one of them. I consider my family. But a teacher can't do this alone. This is about systems. Earlier, Tish talked about everyone's in the room and they can't leave. What if they could? What if I realized that part of handling a strong emotion is separating from the environment? And in my school, that was okay, whether that we put on a lanyard or we carried a stick or somehow I communicated to people in the hallway, I'm taking a break. Because it's not natural to say you're gonna have a strong feeling, you're gonna get frustrated with math, you're gonna be upset at the person sitting next to you, and you have to get over it and keep working. So in SEL, we look at systems. What systems can we put in place to help actually be people that know how to regulate themselves? And it's okay in a school. At the district level, I deal with all of the things. I'm getting the 2-minute mark, so I'm not gonna be able to go over all of them. But I will say that I work closely with HR. When we onboard teachers, what are we looking for? When we have a teacher evaluation, what are we looking for that represents SEL? You know, when I work with safety and security, what is the role of policing in schools? And how does that reflect social emotional learning? My entire team is trained in restorative practices. So what does that mean about restoring students back to their community instead of deciding we don't want you anymore, right? We look at community engagement, transportation of bus drivers, nutrition. SEL is a part of everything that you do. And so it takes the commitment from the district to have a person like me or people like me who look at all of the systems so that teachers can be successful in what they're doing. It cannot be done in isolation. And if I feel all that pressure as a teacher to do it myself, that just adds more stress. I want to say that funding and sustainability is a huge part of this. How do I make sure, like we have a research-based SEL curriculum, how do other schools find those same resources to have a curriculum? I receive calls from states all over this nation that are saying, what are you doing and how can we do it? It is not about interest. We have that. But people know that it's a need, right? It's out there. The question is, what do they do and how do they get it done? And that's where we're asking for support, right? So this research allows people to have a blueprint of what can work in my school. And then our continued funding under Title II, and when we look at ESSA, we said that now we have resources actually put in place best for students. So I want to end on an email I got just yesterday from a teacher in Michigan. I do not know her, but she found me, which is lovely. And she said, I feel like I'm swimming upstream. I don't know where to start. What can we do? I would love to reply, we've got it for you. So thank you.